June 20th regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. And first item on this evening's agenda is last meeting's minutes. Any comments or corrections?
Mr. Chairman, on page 3, second paragraph, second line, this is a lacrosse, just needs to be, there's no space between line and cross. I'm sure that's just a typo. And on page 5, the Fort Williams rest station, I believe that the vote was 4-2 in favor of rejection, because I suspect that you, or as I recall, I think you recused yourself from consideration.
Yes, I did.
Those are my only comments.
Any further comments? Just for the record, at the top of that page, second paragraph, Mr. Howe of Tarion Architects. Tarion is spelled without an H.
Oh, right.
Sometimes it's spelled with an I-A-N, but it's typically without an H. Do you have a motion?
Move to accept the minutes as corrected.
Second.
All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Next item on this evening's agenda is correspondence. I guess before I get into the correspondence, I'd certainly like to congratulate, I don't think congratulate's the right term, but just note that I did see Ms. McKay's article in the Maine Times, and it was quite an article. Very, very impressive.
Thank you.
Additional, under correspondence's environment and development newsletter of April 1995, a Newsweek article for all of those of you who subscribe to Time. This is an excellent Newsweek article regarding development of the suburbs and new moves toward traditional planning. An article on planning for alternative transportation forms, town center stormwater management report prepared by Sebago Technics. This will be available at town hall, I assume. Mm-hmm. Anyone has seen it? Very thorough study. This was a part of our a growth of our town center planning process, where it was realized that a lack of public utilities in the town center made it very difficult to provide parking and development suitable for particular uses. It's also a response to concerns about water quality in the Casco Bay estuary, and indeed a great portion of the report is dedicated toward the discussion of water quality. We have a letter to the town council regarding planning board rules, a letter to the town council regarding the sewer amendments to the zoning ordinance, a letter from planning decisions regarding company changes. For those of you who may or may not know, Evan Rickert was president of Market Decisions, and his appointment as head of the state planning office forced him to separate any ties he had to that business, so they have in turn split into two very closely associated businesses. A letter from Mr. Van Oydis regarding multi-purpose field, an item that was before the council at their last regular meeting. A letter from the Triplers regarding the Perez project. A letter from D. Vallely regarding Spurwink Woods, and a letter from C. Outwin regarding Spurwink Woods. First item under new business on this evening's agenda is a Fitzpatrick Wetland Alteration Permit Public Access Waiver. A request by Joel Fitzpatrick for a wetland alteration permit and a public access waiver for two lots located off Scott Dyer Road, reviewed under Section 19-3-9 Wetland Alteration Permit Completeness. Any background you'd like to give us on this, Maureen?
No, the applicant came for a workshop at last month's meeting. He's proposing to take a lot on Scott Dyer Road, divided into two lots, to install the driveway that's needed to serve both lots. There will need to be some small alteration of wetland. In addition, because the division of the two lots will have less, each lot will have less than the 100 feet of frontage that's required for a lot in this zone. The applicant is also applying for a public access waiver.
Okay, before we proceed with that item, I should also note that there are several items on this evening's table, each one of the members, including amendments to the zoning ordinance.
That's the new zoning ordinance, so you can discard your old one, and this completely replaces it. There's, and this includes the new town center zone amendments, as well as the accessory dwelling unit amendments. There's also a copy of the new planning board rules, which were accepted by the council and will take effect, I think it's July 15th.
Thank you. Are there other, any other items there? A letter to Steve Edsel from the town manager regarding concerns that he had expressed both in comment and in writing to the board chair regarding storage of materials and equipment at the school site in reference to existing plant materials, and also the amended planning board rules and regulations. Okay, with that, let's proceed to the Fitzpatrick Wetland Alteration Permit.
Good evening. My name's Owen McCullough. I'm here on behalf of Joel Fitzpatrick. I'm an engineer with Sebago Technics, who've been working with Joel on his site plan. Joel is here tonight, along with his wife Kelly, right? Okay. If the board likes, I can give a brief run-through on the project, followed by going through the items that is in Maureen's memo and from Steve Bradstreet, if that's acceptable.
Yes, I think that'd be appropriate. Just give us a little background into your, sort of your thinking about the arrangements of the buildings and access and so forth.
Certainly. I'll move over here and speak loud. Joel Fitzpatrick is proposing to divide a lot off the Scott Dyer Road into two lots to be developed as single-family residences. The parcel is owned by Gren Jordan, which is currently under contract by Joel to purchase the property. The parcel's approximately 3 acres in size. The lots would be separated into one lot, which is 0.8 acres, and the other lot's about 2.2 acres. Smaller lot being to the front, which I'll call Lot 1, the one to the back, Lot 2. As Maureen indicated, there's some wetlands on the site, and that's delineated by a bold line, which I'm outlining with my finger here. There's actually three on the site, a third one remotely located away from the construction. But you've got one up here and one in here. And what Joel is proposing is to situate the first lot in between the two wetlands and put the third one on the larger lot in the back. Because of the way the wetlands are configured, only one lot could be located here, one in the back, so he's requesting a public access waiver. That'll require that he constructs a roadway, or a private driveway with an easement to the back. The roadway's been located along the easterly sideline, essentially because that offers the least impact on any wetlands. In fact, the total wetland area, which would be disturbed, is less than 250 square feet. It works. This wetland over here stops here, but this one continues across on the adjacent property, so this worked best for the least disturbance. That will require that they access from here to each of the lots. We're proposing to pave, I believe it's the first 50 feet of the roadway. Because of our efforts to minimize any disturbance on the wetlands, you might see in the minutes that we have to go, we're requesting a waiver to go with a 15-foot radius on this side here. Joel has spoken with the fire chief on this, and what we've talked about doing is widening the road. And I believe the fire chief has asked Joel to speak to the abutting property owners, which I don't believe he really had an opportunity to do at this point. He has spoken to them on the phone, but as far as seeing if we can move this road over, well, not move the road over, but widen the radius out, which would mean we'd encroach slightly on the abutting property. the fire chief has asked that they look into that, which Joel will do between now and the next time we come back to the board. Utilities servicing the site would be water services to each of the buildings, an overhead electric line for services. Each site would be served by onsite wastewater disposal systems. There's HHE 200 forms in your packets. Steve Bradstreet, the town's engineer, had asked about having the septic systems shown on the site plan, which we would do before we come back for a final review with the plan. And those two locations are here and here. We'll just transfer that information onto the plan. We've also delineated a building window on each of the lots. This one's, the first lot's fairly restrictive because of the wetlands. We tried to avoid any encroachment on those wetlands, and we've been fairly successful on, with avoiding that. The back one has a little bit more flexibility for a building window. So what we're proposing is a window in this area that gives Mr. Fitzpatrick the ability to maybe site the house in a different location, depending on whatever the purchaser's desires are. I believe Joel is going to live in this house here, is that correct?
That's right.
That would be your house. Okay. With that, one other note, as indicated in Maureen's memo, the site distance looking easterly was written on the plan as 200 feet. That's incorrect. It's actually 1,200 feet. You're on top of the rise, and you have a good view in that direction. Going the other way, you're looking up towards the intersection with the Spurwink Road, and you can see all the way to the intersection, which is about 700 feet. With that, I'll just run through the minutes that Maureen had. One of the first items is we did do, our soil scientist did a filled wetlands investigation, which was followed, which he flagged the wetlands on the site based upon soils, vegetation, and hydrology. Basically, he went out there and he had to do borings and look at the soils, soil column, look for the water for within a certain distance of the surface and the type of vegetation, in which he flagged the wetlands accordingly. Following that, our survey crew went out and field located each of the wetlands. So those wetlands are located by controlled survey. Since I know that one of the requirements, I spoke with Maureen, is an assessment of wetland vegetation. And I guess what we would do is ask the board to consider a waiver for that. We did do a field evaluation and based it upon actually three criteria for the for the wetlands: soils, vegetation, and hydrology. And I guess this is more of an item for discussion at some point with the board. We talked about the building footprints on the site being within an envelope. We did exclude porches and decks from that simply because if the porches can cantilever over the, can cantilever out from the building without affecting any soils or disturbance. So we were trying to maintain some flexibility there. With that, that was the basis of that. Moving on, in regard to the public access waiver, again, as we mentioned, that there was a typo error on the plan. It's 1,200 feet of site distance. The turning radius Maureen addressed in her item two, which again is back to the fire chief. And Joel will be contacting the neighbor. I believe you spoke with them once on the phone, but you haven't.
I wanted them to see what actually was going on.
I think they're here tonight, I assume, so they'll probably get a chance to speak on this. The Public Works Director had expressed interest on the two water line connections into the Scott Dyer Road. Basically, what we were trying to do with that is avoid the installation of a meter pit. We forward a copy, we have sent a copy of these plans to the Water District, and between now and final, I will be speaking with them. Apparently, the Water District, if you exceed, it's 300 feet for the water service, you have to put in a meter pit. So that's, in this case, that's why this house is pushed to this end of the building window. If Joel wants to set it back further, the Water District will allow that, but then they'll have to do a meter pit. And at that point, probably would do a single service across the Scott Dyer Road.
I understand the town manager has indicated that sidewalks along this section could be possible at some point, so he wanted to make sure that our work didn't impede that. And basically, because of this front wetland, we're staying away from the frontage along the Scott Dyer Road.
Thank you. First thing we have to do before there's any discussion of the application is to review the application completeness for the alteration permit. Does anyone have any questions of Maureen? Any comments regarding completeness? I guess while people are pondering, I will ask why there wasn't a soils map prepared for the area adjacent to the wetlands.
Basically, what we were, as I understand it, the primary concern was soils surrounding, soils indicating wetland areas. And we had sent our soil scientist out there specifically to, he walked the entire site looking at those three criteria I talked about earlier, and which included soils and wetlands and that area. Since those three criteria indicated only wetlands in this area, we were asking that, you know, we focus just on this, on the wetland areas, which I think is the intent behind looking at the soils.
But you haven't done a soils map as such. You haven't identified the soils type other than say that they're upland or wetland soils?
Yes, that's correct. I spoke with Mark Hampton, our soil scientist, today before I came over here, and I did submit a medium intensity soil survey, but of course that's from an aerial survey. Mark, based on his site reconnaissance, indicated to me that from what he saw in his probes out there, the soils towards the front area would be a Swanton soil series, which are considered somewhat poorly drained. And then the soils moving, that would be the wetland areas, and soils moving to the back would be a Swanton or Elmwood, which are a moderately drained soils. We didn't actually delineate them on the plan. Again, we were trying to focus on the wetlands. Mm-hmm.
I guess what I would, on this particular item, ask the board if they have any concern about that. It would seem not unreasonable at all, given the fact that we're dealing both with septic systems here as well as hydric and upland soils, wetland and upland soils, that some mapping would seem to be appropriate, in my opinion, so that there's a public information in terms of the basis for the wetland delineation. And I'll tell you why, because my sense is that that line's going to move after someone moves into the house, whether it's Joel or a future homeowner. I think that line's going to be subject to a lot of aggressive lawn mowing and other activities because of the small building window. And I think for the public record, it would be extremely important not only to have a survey of the delineation of upland and wetland soils, but also the soils classifications. And I would interpret your not submitting a vegetation report in essence what you're then saying is that you're going to take the soils as the most limiting factor in terms of the classification of the wetlands?
Actually, it was based on, as I understand it, for it to be classified as a wetland, you have to meet all three criteria. So what he does is he digs probes throughout the site and looks for the soils that meet all the soils, hydrology, and vegetation that meets all three criteria. And these areas seem to best fit that.
But you haven't submitted a report that classifies the wetland vegetation?
No, you mean the specific types of wetland vegetation?
That's correct.
No.
And the counts or the percentage of wetland versus upland plants?
No, there has not been a report.
I ask the question because oftentimes that's a fairly expensive process, and on larger properties, some applicants prefer to just use the soils mapping, which, as I understand it, is the more restrictive mapping indicator, may or may not be in some cases, but waive the requirement for the other ones. It doesn't sound as though you're exactly doing that, that you, in fact, have done some vegetative mapping, but you haven't classified it and put it on the face of the earth in the forms of a map.
No. If the board, I'm sure, I think Mark has probably done, our soil scientist has done enough work out there that we could, you know, before we came back to final, we could add the wet, I mean, the soils boundaries on the map, and I think he can provide you with, it's basically a soils profile that, you know, I think there are one sheet forms that show the soils types, and he, you know, he could certify them as a soil, if that would seem appropriate.
It would seem appropriate, given the tight site and the density of development that you're proposing. Does the board agree with that?
Yes.
Any other questions regarding completeness? Maureen, on point J, would you give us a little more background on that, please? That's regarding the porches and decks.
Well, building footprints is a technique that the board has moved a little bit away from building footprints at my urging, to be honest, towards building envelopes. Building envelopes are easier to administer because it gives the applicant and the potential buyer some flexibility in exactly what the shape of their house is going to be and the exact placement. At the same time, it doesn't raise questions of, gee, if we moved it 5 feet, do we have to bring it back to the planning board? The applicant in this case has shown actual building footprints as well as a building envelope on the plan because it's a really tight area on that front lot. The interesting thing is once we started with the envelopes, we started debating what is supposed to be inside the building envelope. Is it supposed to be everything, including lawn area and septic system, or is it just supposed to be the principal and accessory dwellings, namely the house and the garage and the tool shed or the tennis court? And the board typically has said, I mean, you've moved a little bit, but you're kind of centered on this idea that it has to be all the structures have to be in the building envelope. To now propose a building envelope where, in fact, not the entire structure has to be inside the envelope may be confusing.
I certainly agree, particularly on a multi-lot subdivision, but I think that it's reasonable to expect that if you have a building envelope in the same way you have a letter envelope, that you assume that the letter fits in the envelope, and one would assume that in a building envelope, the building would fit within the envelope described in the plan. That's not a completeness issue, however. It seemed to be appropriate to have a motion on the completeness at this point. Anyone care to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, let's see. Be it ordered that based on the materials, the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Joel Fitzpatrick for a wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for two lots off Scott Dyer Road be deemed incomplete.
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? Primary reason is it's incomplete is for the additional information on the wetland and vegetative mapping.
Correct. Okay.
All right. Have a second.
I wasn't looking in your direction.
That's all right.
Were you about to plead something?
Yes. I'm trying to understand the process. If it's deemed incomplete, then basically we stop here until the next meeting. Is that correct?
Not necessarily.
Okay. All I'm trying to do is I think there are some other things that we needed to go over tonight.
And I
just didn't want it to, I mean, if it's incomplete, I understand what, you know, the reason is that you're looking for some additional soils in the decks. And if
that's
we could
correct.
Keep going after that.
There's really two opportunities here. One is to deem it complete with conditions or to deem it incomplete as a motion was just passed. The issue with it being incomplete is there is some very important information outstanding, so I think for the public record it's important that we pursue that path at this point. We have other information that we'd like to discuss with you with regard to the public access waiver, and that doesn't require a completeness vote. Maureen?
The only hitch to this is in the past the board has traditionally not scheduled a public hearing until the application is deemed complete. And the ordinance gives the board no discretion in scheduling a public hearing on a wetlands alteration permit, so...
Until we have a complete application.
Right.
That's good discussion, then.
The soils information is certainly available for me to add. All of the work that was out there was done.
All that would be required is that information would be submitted prior to the next meeting in appropriate time, as described in the ordinance, to allow for a public notice in the paper. I guess the procedure now is that we have a motion, and it's been seconded, and we can vote for that. Go ahead and vote for that motion.
I'd like to have a little discussion on it. Have we deemed something complete with conditions before?
As far as I know, we have, but we keep that a very short list, if I remember correctly. It's the inevitable can of worms. The issue is that completeness indicates that it is complete, and it starts the clock ticking in terms of the application. I don't think that it's unreasonable to use good judgment dealing with the scope of the issues at hand, and in terms of the issues that have to be addressed by the wetland mapping, I believe that we have that information in front of us in terms of the survey and the lines marked on the face of the earth as described in the survey. I think what we're asking for is an additional information. It would be almost that item would be checked off in terms of wetlands, and that we're asking for additional information for the record to help us in assessing the application.
I'm not sure this helps, but perhaps the board might be swayed by the fact that it appears from the information that the applicant did submit that this information has already been prepared, that the soils work's already been done. They just happened to not submit it in this package.
Okay.
Perhaps that might have some weight.
I'm not sure which way that cuts, though. I guess that's the difficulty.
It wasn't intended to...
We understand.
Understand that.
Do we still proceed on the...
Don't we have to vote on that motion, then? There's something else we can do then?
Is she able to withdraw at this late date after a second?
If the second agrees.
I withdraw my second.
Do you care to withdraw the motion prior to vote? I mean, yeah, the motion.
Does the second agree? I don't have a strong feeling about it, because I'm not sure.
Can we get to the same point the next meeting either way?
No, the issue is it essentially delays them an entire meeting, because they have to submit the information. We have to deem it to be complete, and then only then can we advertise for the public hearing.
But if they submit the information, we still, if we're not satisfied, we will not proceed, correct?
We can still table it.
That's correct.
Okay, then I'd like to withdraw my second, then.
Okay. Do we have a motion? Another motion? Mr. Parker?
I withdraw my motion.
Oh, I thought you already had. Okay. Mr. Parker?
Okay, motion for the board to consider, excuse me, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Joel Fitzpatrick for wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for two lots off Scott Dyer Road be deemed complete, with the condition that these soils, I'm not sure how to phrase this.
And vegetation.
Soils and vegetation, results that are already have already been done be depicted on the plan or just enumerated on a separate piece of paper for our consideration. Help me with this one.
We would show the soils boundary right on the plan for you, and then you'd get, you know, a soils profile along with it. I mean, that's typically what's done for a high intensity.
That's good.
If that's okay.
We have a motion. I have a second. Second. Any further discussion? It's understood you'll provide the soils mapping, the vegetative analysis, and any reports on hydrology.
Okay.
Thank you. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. All those against? Passes, what is it, 5-1?
No. 5-1.
Was it 5-1?
I voted for it.
Yeah, okay, it's 5-1. Okay, continuing, next item for discussion is the public access waiver. Since we've already gone through most of the items, do you have any further enlightenment?
The stickiest part of this is the turning radius, and it's not a problem of Scott Vera Road being too narrow or the driveway being too narrow. It's just that as you narrow up one road, the radius that you need needs to increase. So right now, the town ordinance says you need a 20-foot wide radius for public access waiver. On many roads, 20 feet is not going to accommodate the ladder truck. So, and the problem is that there's plenty of radius space heading east, but it's every expectation that if there was an emergency on this site, that the fire truck would be coming from the town center and heading west. So the side that you need the turning radius on is where you don't have it. The applicant has pulled the radius. First, they've pulled the driveway as close, as far away from the wetland as I can to avoid having to fill or otherwise alter the wetland. So they're approximately, you know, 5 to 10 feet away from the property line. Then when you create a radius that cuts right across the point where the property line meets the road, you don't have an adequate radius for the fire truck. The fire truck will either cross onto the Whitaker's property or hit the edge of the wetland, which neither is preferable. So the problem is, as you're turning in, you either have the option of trying to get permission from the abutting property owner to cross their property, or you've got to look at filling part of the wetland in order to achieve the radius. While the fire, I spoke to the fire chief about this earlier, and he has asked the applicant to speak with the neighboring property owners to see if they would be willing to allow some crossing on their property. If they are not willing to do that, then I believe he's going to be asking the planning board to agree to allow a greater impact on the wetlands so we can achieve the radius he needs.
Unless I'm mistaken, I don't see the wetland boundary on my plans.
It's the dark dashed line.
Oh, it is the dashed line. Okay. All right, before we, that's an issue, is there any other issues, Maureen?
I think, you know, the other ones have been mentioned by the applicant, and those I expect will be addressed prior to the next meeting.
Yes, the other items were related to, actually they came from, mostly from Steve Bradstreet's letter. He made mention about the entrance grade coming into the site. He said he just asked to have a note on the plan. It will be less than 2% grade. It's not a very steep grade. The entire site's fairly flat out there. So he just asked that a note be added on that, and that kind of relates to another one of his comments. One of our goals was in setting the elevations of this road to match this side of the road into the existing grade, and then put a cross pitch on the road so the drainage goes internal to the site, avoiding any impact on the abutter's property. And one of Steve's other comments was having some grade information on that road. And thinking about that, I think I spoke with Maureen on it. I would envision placing some spot grade information for final. It's more for construction, so there's some control over the when it gets built. And we will certainly do that.
Thank you.
Certainly.
Any questions regarding public access? Ms. McKay?
No, I don't. This is really not public access in a way, but I don't want to lose sight of the porches and decks point. I would like to suggest that it is, it would be much more preferable from my point of view anyway to include, you can exclude septic systems as being outside the building envelope, but I would like to see no exception for decks and porches.
From the input I got from the board, I have every intention on changing that.
I just didn't want to leave that point.
What I'll probably do is between now and well, probably tomorrow, I'll sit down with Joel so I know exactly where he thinks he's going to put decks, and I'll just put the envelopes around that, and I'll certainly change that.
Thanks.
Certainly.
Any other comments? I guess I'll throw a big can of gasoline on the fire here, so to speak. Public access waivers have been in the town ordinance for some time, and they serve a function of allowing construction behind properties primarily, or access to properties without having to build to town standards. That is, an individual would not be forced, because they don't have enough frontage to build a town road, so to speak, to get to a single-family home. It has, in many cases, led to development that is not what I would say typical to the goals of the comprehensive plan, that is preservation of rural character. It does on the one hand, and on the other hand, it seems to many times take it away. When this came before us in workshop, I expressed some concerns about the fact that you had one house located directly behind the other. And regardless of the fact that you're proposing to live in one house, I think ultimately we have to think of these as houses that are on the market for sale. And I think a concern I have is the way in which, given the total area of land that's available to build on, is the impact that one house has on the other. And it almost seems, although I'm not interested in the marketing of these houses, that the proximity of the houses would lower the value of each, and that perhaps both in terms of the comprehensive plan as well as potential impacts on wetland and in terms of marketability and in terms of preservation of rural character, it may be appropriate to either relocate the houses or reconsider whether or not you're developing two houses in the configuration that you show now. That's one planning board member's opinion. It's a real concern of mine in terms of the use of this public access waiver. I'm particularly concerned because I know what happens. It certainly happened in the Brentwood neighborhoods when the wetland regulations were adopted, that people have a tendency to clear anything adjacent to their house. There aren't markers out there that every time you go to mow your lawn, the buzzer goes off when you get to that edge. The only thing that normally will stop one is either the driveway, the fence, or a disgruntled abutter. I think the example I used at our workshop was the example in Scarborough where someone had a road on Spurwink, is that, or Bowery Beach Road, out beyond Pleasant Hill. And they had a view down the marsh, and somehow someone came in and got a permit to build a house sitting in the marsh. Not only does the house sit in the marsh, but it faces directly to the house that was pre-existed. And there was any number of opportunities to reorient things and to preserve views and protect property values. Here, I think you're almost building in this dilemma where you have a living space facing someone's backyard. And it's going to take a lot of convincing, for me at least, to grant a public access waiver, approve a public access waiver, when my opinion is really leading to detrimental development patterns on Scott Dyer Road. That can be argued in any number of ways according to what the ordinance allows you to do and what you can prove to the board, but that's a very strong opinion I have. And I raise that now. I raise it at the workshop, and I raise it now because I don't take the investment that is necessary to get to where you are lightly. I know that's a significant expenditure. And I just want to forewarn you, as one board member, I have some real concerns about the proposal that's before us.
Can I just say one thing?
I don't know at this point. What I'd like to do is to have the other board members comment either on that issue or to give a little more insight to any other concerns they have to dealing with the public access waiver, and then give you an opportunity to. It's clear from the way in which the site is configured that you have two wetland, you have the wetland separating the two properties, and there may be growth there, so the views from one property to another is maintained as being fairly private. But it would seem to me to be appropriate that we may have a site walk, and I just want to forewarn you that as we go down the road, I don't want this to be a discussion that comes as a result of a public discussion or a couple of meetings away after you've invested a lot of time. I want to be right up front with my concerns. Do any other planning board members share any similar concerns or something that we want to alert the applicant to?
I share your same concern, and I thought about this a lot this afternoon, trying to think of what I could suggest instead of just criticizing. And is it possible to orient the house on the front lot, possibly So the back of the house is facing the back of the other house, so they're not, I don't know, I get this awful sort of vision or something of having a house staring at someone else's living space. You just see that too many places, and it adversely affects everyone all the way down the line. And the two houses that Tom are referring to in Scarborough, interestingly enough, the one that came later went on the market, sold very quickly. The one that came first, who had the nice view that got interrupted, has been on the market now, I think, for about 8 or 9 months and has not sold. So there is something to be considered there. I know there's a concern about keeping the house on lot two toward the front of the building envelope. It seems that maybe economics, a little bit of economics aside, it may make more sense to position it somewhere else in that building envelope at a different angle, possibly, to make each lot seem more private. And I know that the building envelopes are on the plan, and that is an option. I just don't want people that may be looking at buying either one of these houses to feel that they have to, you know, place the house on lot two where it's located on the plan, because I think it's going to have a detrimental effect. And I'm just sharing that as a, I don't know, my viewpoint. I guess I'm also concerned about it just being stacked, if you follow me. Is there, you know, possibility of rearranging them so they're side by side, so they're not infringing upon each other and they're actually being neighbors as opposed to something, you know, the plan that we have in front of us? I just throw that out for you to consider and maybe, you know, think about. I don't have a preconceived notion how I'm going to vote on the public access waiver, but I guess I'd like to see some other possibilities on the arrangement of the lots. Thanks.
Thank you. Any other board members' comments? Thank you. Joel, you wanted to say something?
Yes. We've given a lot of thought to the privacy issue and the stacking of the homes. Being a builder, I was concerned about that also, but looking at the lot, looking down on it like this, it's easy to say that, but if you actually were there, I mean, if you did want to take the sidewalk, I'd recommend that because of you'd be able to, if you could stand here, we do have pictures. I did bring some pictures with me, and Owens has them. It is pretty heavy here. Even in the winter, if you're standing on this lot, you really can't see this one. And the reason we did do the, I wanted to get the biggest envelope possible in the back lot so I can give the, this one is going to be built first. This one I'm going to wait until I have a customer. And I am going to give him his the opportunity to pick where he wants this home. If you do put it over on this side, it will be a little more private. It's just going to be a little more of an expense for the water line, approximately $2,000, which is not that bad. So if that was my lot and I was going to spend whatever amount on this project, I would say spend the $2,000 more and get the home over here. I put it over here just to give the people the option of this whole thing. If you would like to see the pictures, I do have them. We stood here, we took pictures from this angle, we took pictures from this angle, and like I said, even in the wintertime when there's no vegetation growth, there's trees, there's shrubs, this is the part of the wetland, so we cannot touch it, which, even if it wasn't wetland and I could touch it, I wouldn't, just for the privacy factor of the whole thing. We did, before we designed this whole thing, we were thinking of putting a home here and a home here, and you just go out there and look at this lot, and if you were the one that was going to purchase these, it's just going to be much more private the way we have it, instead of having two side by side. If you looked at the lot, it's just easy to see that when you're looking down on it like this.
I think, at least from my opinion, it would be very important to have a site walk to, yes, get appreciation of the situation that dictated this solution.
Yes. Thank you.
Mr. Stone?
Oh,
sidewalk myself.
This one right here is requested, that's lot two.
Excuse me, I don't think there's any need to go through those at this time. What we'll do is we'll go to the site, and even the best photographs are sometimes difficult to appreciate.
Right.
Oftentimes, particularly when you photograph wetlands and wildlands, one picture's as good as 100. What you see in person is much more important.
Right.
I guess what I'm raising here is just the issue that you should be ready for board comments at the site walk, or questions, and I guess I would, as one implore that you be very convincing in your discussions about why and where, particularly in light of the total lot area provided. With that, what I'd like to do is ask Maureen a question regarding the access to the site. Is there a limitation to the number of curb cuts that can be made into Scott Dyer Road? Could two driveways be cut, or do you not have adequate front yard for that?
There's no limit on how, there's no connection between how much frontage you have and how many driveways, curb cuts you can get. It's basically limited by site distance, and the Public Works Director issues the driveway, the curb cut permit. In this case, the biggest limitation is, if we were to put a driveway anywhere else, you'd have to demonstrate why that particular impact on the wetland was justified.
So the only place that the wetland crossing can occur to the rear lot is along the easterly property line at that narrow section?
Yes, that's correct. The wetland, you know, begins on the, I guess it would be the westerly parcel, and all kind of fingers its way through, and then it stops just shy of, well, just about at the edge of the easement that we're showing. There'll be a little bit of grading within the wetland, which will be part of the 250 square feet that we talked about.
These were classified as RP2?
Mm-hmm.
All right, do we have a motion on the public access waiver, or any further discussion? Or there's a motion? Anyone like to make a motion regarding the public access waiver?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that the above application be tabled to the regular July 18th, 1995 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Would like to set a time for a site walk, preferably during the week and the evening if possible. Is next Tuesday convenient with people? Well, Maureen won't be here. It would have to be next week, though, in order for them to meet the deadline. Or this week.
This week is out for me.
Okay, I thought so. It's out for me, too.
This week or next week?
This week. Next Tuesday would be fine with me. It's all right with you guys?
How about Monday?
Mondays, ooh. Sure, why not Monday? Anyone have a problem with Monday?
What time?
5:30?
5:30.
Is that a good time for everyone?
That's fine.
Okay.
That's next Tuesday?
Next Monday.
Next Monday.
The 26th?
Monday, the 26th. At 5:30.
Where are you going to meet?
Where are we going to meet?
The parking's difficult at the site along, I mean, I don't know, it's a condominium complex to the west. There seems to be some parking inside there. They may not appreciate it, but...
On the through road?
Yeah. I mean, if it's temporary, I would...
Or the Viking.
Would you mind calling the Viking and asking if it's appropriate? Can he do that, or...
I don't mind calling.
Okay, Maureen doesn't mind calling.
See, now I don't know who they are. I'm glad Maureen's going to do it. Thank you.
I just don't want 12 vehicles to show up there unannounced during visiting hours or something.
It's going to sound like a crazy question, but how walkable is the site? I mean, if we're coming from work, the work clothes on, are we going to rip them to shreds, or are we going to...
Well, if it's been a dry day, you know, of course, the wetland areas are you don't want to go through those because they're very dense scrub growth and tree growth, so it's very difficult walking through that. But walking in along where the access road goes, it's very passable. Okay. If, you know, if it's been a rainy day, it's like any site. There'll be mud and
Yeah, the grass is quite high.
Okay.
Ticks as well. Maureen, will the abutters be noticed on the notified of the pub, of the site walk?
Just the people, the direct abutters are here, so okay. It's just people who watch this meeting who'll be aware of the sidewalk, and you know, anyone that shows up can attend and accompany the board on the sidewalk. So we usually don't send out notices.
Okay. Well, I think if we have the abutters here this evening, that's okay.
Mr. Emery, I have a question for you. As I understand it, the public hearing is scheduled for the next meeting, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And the process, if we walk through the site on Tuesday and we overcome some of these questions and we come back for the next meeting, would it be appropriate at that time that this project could be approved, or would it actually take another meeting? I'm just trying to get a sense of the time frame.
In theory, it could be approved. That's correct. In theory.
And for Maureen, I'd ask the other question. If we walk the site next Tuesday and...
Monday.
I have Tuesday. Everybody said Tuesday, so I better write this down quick. If we walk the site next Monday and there are some, I mean, depending on what the outcome, if we need to resubmit some plans...
The submission deadline for the July meeting is next Friday. So it's
so we could,
June 30th. So you meet on Monday, and then you've got the rest of the week to get your plans together for Friday afternoon submission.
Okay. Great.
Plenty of time. Boy, that's 3.5 days.
That's all right.
No, in all seriousness, if you were to, as a result of the site walk, there were some indications of major complications in the application, it may necessitate that you... I guess it's only fair to say it may be appropriate to come back to a workshop meeting. Is that correct, Maureen?
The first workshop that would be available would be August.
August.
You know, assuming that, well, I guess we got to have to see how the site walk goes, and that might be a, depending on
well,
how it goes.
Let's have the site walk and see, how it goes.
Okay.
Good. Right.
Is that it?
Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yep. Next item on this evening's agenda is actually a resubmission of a wetlands alteration permit. Maureen, would you give us a little background on this? This is primarily due to the permits lapsing since their previous approval?
Yes, there in March of 1993, the board approved a public access waiver for a lot, and a wetlands alteration permit, by the way, for a lot on Silva Drive, which is near the Elizabeth Farms subdivision. Public wetlands alteration permits have an expiration date of 1 year. The applicant put the lot, my understanding is they put the lot on the market, and have just recently had someone come forward who's interested in purchasing the lot, reviewed the permits, and realized that the wetlands alteration permit had expired. The ordinance says that if it's expired, you've got to come back in for a new permit. So what they have done is the public access waiver part is still valid. So we're only asking for a wetlands alteration permit here. What they've done is they've submitted the same plans that were approved by the board in March of 93 with an application fee, and are requesting that the board reissue the permit. Again, the procedure is that you need to deem the application complete, and and then you have no option but to schedule a public hearing, which the earliest that could be advertised for is for the July meeting.
Before we get into discussion, I'd like to ask Maureen one question. Has there been any changes in the ordinances that affect the development of the site since the plan was approved?
No, and there have been no physical alterations of the site either.
Okay, thank you. Does the board require a presentation? It's the first.
I didn't hear what you said.
Does the board require a presentation? Okay. Can we entertain a motion on completeness then?
Motion for the board to consider.
Now, Mr. Parkhurst.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Cantel Corporation for a wetlands alteration permit for a lot located off Silver Drive be deemed complete.
Second that.
Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Okay. Next.
Thank you.
Well, we actually can't approve it at this meeting, correct?
No, you have to hold a public hearing.
Okay. So we have to schedule a public hearing.
Right.
Next meeting. Can you have your application materials ready by the next meeting in July? Before we go to the motion, I have one question, and that's regarding the dating of the documents. Would it be appropriate, Maureen, to revise the documents to either today's date or the public hearing date?
To be quite honest, my experience has been that once these documents start getting worked on by an applicant, those dates often do not get updated, and so I put my own dates on them. Whether or not they revise the date, there will be a date affixed to it by the planning office. So it's up to the board.
I would like to have a current date placed on the plans. Anybody else?
Yes, I would too. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Did you do that? Just date them to the, at the time you resubmitted them, I think would be appropriate.
Okay.
With that, have a motion for holding a public hearing for the next regular meeting in July. Janet?
Go ahead.
Mr. Chair, be it further ordered that the above application be tabled to the regular July 18, 1995 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second.
Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Congratulations.
Now you can leave.
I would like to also say that I hope when the plan is submitted that we have you adopt the recommendation of the town engineer with respect to the 25-foot radii.
It has been done.
Yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I submitted a letter as part of the Fitzpatrick package, and you didn't mention it. I was given an hour to write the letter last week, so I did the best I could.
Okay, that's. Let me just mention that for the record, and again, we will be holding a public hearing as well. The letter.
I wanted to make sure that you received the letter.
Yes. Okay. Letter from N. Whitaker regarding Fitzpatrick. Does that adequately describe that?
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you for pointing that out. While I'm thinking of it, Maureen, we didn't discuss the Conservation Commission. Are they normally invited to the site walk?
I will notify them that there is going to be a site walk.
It won't be necessary for a site walk for the Cantel things. We've already done one of that, correct?
That's correct. Unless the board wanted to go on another site walk. Have there been any changes in the ordinances? That might have been a different issue, but nothing has changed. Next item on this evening's agenda under new business is the open space impact fee Maureen, could you give us a little background on this?
Certainly. The board's been working on this for several months. Right now, the subdivision ordinance has a standard that requires that new development dedicate open space and recreational facilities as part of the subdivision. If they, for some reason, do not wish to set aside land for open space, then they can pay a fee equal to 10% of the assessed value of the property. In the wake of some Supreme Court decisions in the last 5 years, and in the wake of some state law that's been adopted, this standard really needs to be updated to be consistent with those decisions and that state law. The best way to do that is to restructure the existing standard into an impact fee. So what you have before you is a revised Section Q in the subdivision ordinance, which in fact allows the planning board and the town to continue to do what you've been doing all along, which is setting aside land as part of development. But it's restructured so that it's more legally defensible. Again, if land that is to be set aside is, if there is to be no land set aside, the applicant will be required to pay a fee, and the structure is set up for that. The major change in this is instead of snatching a 10% number out of the air, you're actually requiring the new development to meet to set aside land, which is equivalent to the amount of land that the town currently has under control. That number was established by doing an inventory, and I mentioned the land trust because they're in the audience, but what we've done is we've done an inventory of all the open space land that's owned by the town, all the land set aside as open space for which the town has an easement, land to which the land trust owns, where there is legal public access, and land which the land trust has an easement over, which provides legal public access. And we've taken all of that together, divided that by the town's population, and come up with a community standard, a per capita land per person ratio. We've then asked the assessor to come up based on his professional standards and his experience in the town with an average amount, average value of land per acre, vacant land, and he has done that. That's what we've used to establish the fee. So what you have before you is the actual subdivision ordinance language, which you need to forward to the town council with some recommendation for their consideration. The other piece of this is that while there's been a lot of research done to establish what the maximum fee is, if a fee is going to be collected, the actual fee amount has to be set by the town council. Mm-hmm. Now, you could choose to actually recommend a certain fee to them, either, you know, whether you think they should charge the maximum amount allowable or whether a lesser amount may be more appropriate. But the main thing you'll be doing tonight will be looking at the language of this new standard, and also a public hearing has been scheduled and advertised for this evening.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments by the board or questions? With that, what I'd like to do is to open the meeting to the public hearing. Are there any members from the public that wish to speak for or against the proposed language? Would you please come up and introduce yourself and give your name and address?
My name's Randy Blake. I live at 2 Ivy Road, Cape Elizabeth. Richard Blake. I just had one question. You sent this to me, Maureen. I appreciate that. I read some of it. How does the mechanics work? When is the fee paid? How is it collected? Who is it paid by?
The way, through the chair, the way we set
Please.
It up is that the last line of the whole provision states that any required fee shall be paid prior to the commencement of construction of the subdivision and or issuance of a building permit. So it's supposed to be paid around the same time that a performance guarantee is issued by the town. So before earth is disturbed, the fee should be paid. But a fee is only paid if land is not donated.
Right.
If a fee is paid, it is supposed to, and that's in the administration section, The fee is supposed to be set aside by the town into an account, and it's supposed to be spent on acquisition or improvement of open space. So it's not an amount that's supposed to go into the general fund and be used for anything. And it's called a fee because it is something that can be returned. It has to be spent within a specified period of time. If it's not spent within that time period, it is supposed to be returned to the developer. The time period we've selected is 10 years, and that we can defend because we have a capital improvements plan that's supposed to be for 10 years, so.
Can the developer post a bond or a letter of credit to cover that fee for a period of time?
The fee is supposed to be an actual amount that is given to the town, whereas a bond is something that is supposed to be returned when performance has been achieved. And this is something that either there's a land donation or there's a fee donation, and if you want to get it back, you've got to hope the town doesn't spend it.
I just, putting on my hat as a lender who does a lot of subdivision lending, I'm sure some people are going to come and say, I don't have the cash to pay this upfront, but I can do it via a letter of credit to be paid over, you know, within a year or something like that. Is that an acceptable alternative?
I'm not the person who decides what's the financial tool that's most acceptable. If I was asked, I would say no, but.
Okay.
Randy, we did discuss that at length, and a problem that always develops for most municipalities is there's a proportion of one's inability to pay to the difficulty one has in collecting the money later in the process. And there was quite a bit of concern expressed that if, on the one hand, someone is contributing land and the town has access to that land and it's there, it's visible, and it's deeded, on the other hand, another developer who either doesn't have the option to contribute the land or chooses not to and would rather contribute money should do the same by providing cash, so to speak. And I don't know of many developments where the upfront money is not always an issue. And there's no developer worth a salt who wants to spend a dime more than he absolutely has to. But in this case, at least for this part of the process, we felt that it was quite important that money be available upfront, and it is in escrow, and it's not in the conservation fund behind the license plate. It's in a separate dedicated fund in town.
Where impact fees are common in other states, it's become common practice that the fee is treated as a soft cost, which is part of the costs that are funded by banks, just as a building permit would be funded. So I think there's still the possibility for that. In other, like I said, in other states, it's just one more cost of doing business.
Okay, thanks.
And I think from the standpoint of expressing your concerns, I think if we recommend this to the council would be the perfect place to raise those sorts of concerns because they're going to be dealing with the financial implications and the political issues related to that. The planning board, I think, has to take more of the stricter environmental approach and the not single-minded, but the more direct approach than the council sometimes has to.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Otherwise, I think it's great.
Any other members of the public who wish to speak? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Any further discussion by the board? I'd like to thank Maureen for an excellent presentation on the often very complex issue. Do I hear a motion? Entertain a motion? Mr. Edsel.
Mr. Chair, I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the material submitted and the facts presented, the open space impact fee amendment to the subdivision ordinance, section 6.
16.
Shouldn't that be 16?
Yep.
16.31Q be recommended to the town council for consideration.
Second.
Second. Any further discussion?
I thought there was a whole section of the ordinance that I'd never seen before.
I congratulate you for pausing. Let's have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. All those opposed? Okay. It passes, what is it, 6-1.
I'd also like to suggest that we recommend to the town council that they establish the fee at the maximum amount.
That's a good point. And consistently as such. Do you wish to make that an amendment to the motion?
Well, we've already passed the motion, so I guess I'd like to have that be a, yes, an addition to the motion, yeah, fine.
Second?
I'll second it for discussion. I'm trying to get caught up here in the language. That's in the last paragraph.
Where would you like to see that inserted, Janet?
I'd just like to add a separate sentence. In addition to the B, the recommended for consideration, the planning board suggests that the town council establish the fee at the maximum amount generated by the calculation.
We can strike that, or we can cure part of that by striking the second half of the first sentence on the second page. Town council may establish a fee at the maximum amount and drop the or may choose a lesser amount, and change the first half to recommend. No, this is an ordinance. We don't make recommendations in ordinances. You'd have to say the town council shall establish the fee at the maximum amount. See what I'm saying?
But this is a memo to us that...
I'm sorry.
Yep.
That's why nobody's following me. Forget that I even spoke.
I was on the same page you were.
Had half of them going anyway, didn't I?
I'd just like to add another sentence to the order that says the planning board suggests that the town council establish the fee at the maximum amount, period.
Okay, and we have a second?
I'll second that. Okay. I did second.
Discussion on that? For the council's benefit, I would like to ask that you, for the record, explain why it should be set at the maximum.
Because the amount of open space is a very serious consideration on behalf of the town, and if we are requiring that the fee be paid in lieu of land set aside, and the calculation is intended to approximate the value of the land, it seems to me that it's only fair and equitable to have the full fee be the fee that's assessed. Otherwise, there would be an incentive built in for the developer to pay a fee instead of setting aside the land itself.
And certain developers would approach the process differently depending upon various connections within the town council. I think we're quite fortunate we don't have that problem in town, but that's something that could always, by not setting the maximum fee, could become an issue. And ultimately it'd be the town council's vote whether or not to include that language. Okay. All those in favor of the second motion? All opposed? We're consistent.
Mm-hmm.
Six in favor, one opposed. That's the last item on the evening agenda. Any other discussions or items before I entertain a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
That was not a motion. I'm entertaining a motion.
Make a motion that we adjourn.
Okay. Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Yeah.
It passes. Are you voting in favor of the adjournment?
Yes.
Unanimous. Thank you.
Maureen, workshop.